Okay, we're Shmuel Aleph, Perek Yud Zayin, Pasuk Chof Tes. Today we'll have David and Goliath. Pasuk Chof Tes. The simple meaning, like we mentioned last time, David had gone around asking, what will happen to the person who strikes down this Plishti? Goliath had stood for 40 days disgracing Klal Yisrael, that nobody had the courage and the fortitude to even attempt to fight Goliath. So David said, what's going to happen to the person who strikes down this Plishti and he removes that disgrace? And Eliav became angry at David, and he said, oh, you left the sheep and you came here, you just want to see the excitement of war. But Yomer David, David said, Me'o sisiyata, what did I do now? I can understand many times in the past you were upset with me, but what did I do? Hello, Dabru, I was just speaking to the people. I was asking what's going to happen to the one who kills Goliath. Another explanation given is, when a rational person does an irrational thing, there's usually a reason for it. David said, Me'o sisiyata, what did I do? Imagine, you're right, let's say I left the sheep and they were unprotected and I came here just to see what's going on with the war. Do you really think that's my whole intention? What did I do? Think into, there must be, hello Dovarhu, there must be something, an underlying reason, there must be some substance to what I did. Just to assume that I'm doing something so crazy to leave the sheep and just come to watch the war. Vayisuv miyetzlo. David turned from him, El Mulacher, and he went to another person. Vayomer kadover hazen, he said the same thing. What will happen to the person who strikes down the Plishti? Vayishivu ha'om dover. And the people responded to David with the same answer, kadover harishon, like the first statement, that whoever kills Goliath, whoever kills this Plishti, the king promised he'll make that person very wealthy, he'll be able to marry the king's daughter, and his whole household won't have to pay any taxes, won't be subservient to the king. David didn't directly go to Shaul and volunteer. Vayishamu hadvarim, the words were heard, Asher Diber David, that David had spoken. The fact that David kept on walking around and asking what's going to happen, people found out there's obviously somebody interested in this offer. Vayagidu lifnei Shaul, they told it over before Shaul that somebody's going around and inquiring what happens to the one who defeats Goliath. Vayikacheu, and Shaul immediately took him. Shaul was looking for somebody after day after day after day, and he didn't know what's something's got to happen. HaKadosh Baruch Hu has to help us some way. And the fact that somebody was interested, immediately Shaul heard, and he had David brought. It could be David didn't go directly to Shaul simply because his anivus, his humility, didn't allow him to just go to Shaul and say, I'm the one, I'll go fight Goliath. He preferred that others should make the offer. So he let it be known that he was interested, and then if Shaul would pick up on that hint and bring him, so then David would respond that he's ready. But to go himself and just volunteer and say, I'm the one, he didn't want to do. Or it could be that he realized Shaul wouldn't accept it, the generals wouldn't accept it. How could a guy come, and he's supposed to represent Klal Yisrael, even if, as we discussed last time, it wasn't a condition like a duel that whoever's defeated all of Klal Yisrael will be avodim, even without that understanding. But the person is going to represent Klal Yisrael, and if he's going to go and just be 1, 2, 3 killed, it'll be a disgrace. And what's the point? Anybody who goes should fight Goliath and be killed, and then what do you gain? If he would go to Shaul and say, I'll fight Goliath, Shaul would say no. What he did was he spread the word among the masses that he's interested. And then there was, to a certain extent, the public support. The word came to Shaul for that people came. It could be a number of people. Vayagidu l'Shaul, they told Shaul. It just, he heard from different people, somebody's interested. And once the people had an interest that somebody will defend their honor, somebody will speak up and fight for Klal Yisrael, then already Shaul's more amenable to accepting David as our as our defender. Vayomer David el Shaul. David said to Shaul, Al yipol leiv adam olav. Nobody's heart should sink, should fall. They shouldn't be discouraged. Not Shaul, but he didn't say directly your heart. But Al yipol leiv adam could be anybody. Nobody should feel discouraged. Avdecha yelech. Your servant will go, which is in general when you speak to the king, you refer to yourself as a servant. And certainly David was aware of the fact that Shaul had this possible jealousy of this Ruach Ra, so he certainly couched his offer that I'm your servant, Avdecha Yelech, your servant will go, V'nilcham im ha-plishti hazeh, and he'll fight with this plishti. By mentioning it's Avdecha, it's your servant, meaning I'm not important, I'm just your servant. And even on the chance that David would be killed, it's not a disgrace to Klal Yisrael. It's not like the king went out to war and the king was defeated. A guy went out and Avdecha Yelech, this person went, and it could be I'll win, could be I'll lose. But even if I lose, it's not such a disgrace. I'm just a regular Eved. Vayomer Shaul el David. Shaul said to David, what do you mean? It's not a suffix whether you win or whether you lose, and even if you lose, it's not so bad. You're definitely going to lose. Lo sucha lo leches ala plishti hazeh. You're not able to go to this plishti. Forget about fighting. You're not even able to go to him. The contest is such a mismatch, it's just not possible, Elohim Imo. You can't go to go to him to fight. There's two problems. Look at a regular war. And a regular soldier who's experienced and he knows how to fight. You're worse than a regular soldier. Kinar ato. You're just a lad. You're young, you're inexperienced. He was almost 30, but he wasn't a seasoned warrior. You're an Arya. You're a lad, you're a young one. You can't fight. So you're worse than a regular soldier. And look at your opposition. V'hu ish milchama minu urov. And he, Goliath, is a man of war from his youth. He's fought many, many battles. Besides the fact we had before that he's the one who was involved in destroying Mishkan Shiloh. He captured the Oron. He killed Chofni and Pinchas, the sons of Eli. He's a man of war. So he's much better than your average soldier, and you're much worse. So you can't even go. It's not a suffix. How can we send you? Obviously, Shaul wasn't relying on a nace, wasn't relying on some special hashkocha protis. He was just looking at the simple statistics, the simple chances, b'derech hateva, would a Kadosh Baruch Hu, normally the world goes b'derech hateva, and is David able to defeat Goliath? When David heard that, David responded, even b'derech hateva, even in the simple manner that you would understand two people fighting. It's not hopeless, and it makes sense that I should go. Vayomer David el Shaul, David said to Shaul, Roe hoya avdecha, your Evid, your servant was a shepherd. And he still served as a shepherd. But his main function now was to be with Shaul and to play music when Shaul wanted it. The shepherd is sort of past history, right? That's his secondary job now. Roe hoya avdecha, your servant was a shepherd. La'avi for his father, batzon among the sheep. Uvo ha'ari, the lion came. Ve'esadov, and the bear came. Ve'nosa se meho eder. And the animal carried off a sheep from the flock. The simple meaning would be the ari came, and another time a bear came, and whichever animal attacked carried off a sheep. But all the mefarshim mention, starting from the Targum, that it means v'vah ha'ari, the lion came, v'es ha'dov, together with a bear. The two animals got together and it was a joint attack. A lion and a bear came at the same time and one of them grabbed a sheep. When an army fights a war, usually the outcome is determined based on one of three factors. The number of soldiers, which army has the greater quantity of men, the quality of the soldiers, or the weaponry, or their quality, and the third factor is the determination, and sometimes you can have an underdog who's who has less soldiers and he has less equipment, but somehow there's such a fierce determination or a hatred or toward the enemy they're able to overcome. David mentioned when he was the shepherd, there was a time that he was attacked, or that an Ari and a dove came. They came to take a sheep. It was a lion and a bear together. It was more than just one creature. There were two of them. And we'll see later on in this Chazal, there was even more than that. But there was the Ari and the dove together, the lion and the bear came. And among the animals, the lion's the king of the animals, and the bear is even a fiercer warrior. These are two of the mightiest animals. The quality of the fight is certainly with them. And he grabbed a sheep from the flock. We'll see in a moment what gave them there, why they were determined more than the average animal to fight. By the way, there is a ksiv. The way we have it in our Nevi'im, and the way the Mincha Shai says is correct, is the way we read it. V'nosa seh, that the animal carried away a sheep. But there are those who say the word is actually v'nosa zeh. It's written in the Navi, v'nosa zeh. He carried this from the flock. What did he carry? After the sheep was captured by the lion, or the bear, when David got a hold of the sheep, which we'll see in a moment, David took that animal, that sheep, he shechted it, and he used the skin of the animal to make a belt. And wherever David went, he remembered the chesed and the nes that HaKadosh Baruch Hu did with him, that he was able to overcome a lion or a bear. Very often a person has something happen to him, maybe not a nes on this scale, but something special happens and you forget about it. David had the belt on to remind him, made from that sheep. So v'nosa zemi ha'edu would mean he carried this, man, he showed Shaul, this sheep that I'm wearing, this belt, comes from the sheep that I rescued from the lion or the bear. But as I say, the Mincha Shai says the girsa, the correct reading is v'nosa seh, that the lion or the bear carried away a sheep. V'yotzasi achrov, I went after that animal. I went after the lion or the bear. V'yikisiv, and I hit it. Now that gets the lion pretty angry. You don't go ahead and hit a lion or a bear. V'hitzalti mipiv. Not only that, I saved the sheep from the animal's mouth. And when the animal has its mouth on the sheep and you grab the supper away from it, you take the sheep right out of the animal's mouth, the animal will be furious. So there's... it would seem that David wouldn't have a chance. Vayokam alai. The animal got up against me. He turned his attention to who's this person stealing away the sheep. Vechazakti bizakono. And I grabbed the mane of the animal, the hair. I grabbed a hold of it. It wasn't like he shot it with a bow and arrow from far away. In other words, at this point it was a struggle. And I grabbed it by its mane, v'hikisiv, and I struck that animal, v'hamitiv, and I killed it. The interesting thing is, it wasn't like David was even attacked. Initially, the sheep was carried away. And David went after it. V'yotzasi achrov, he went after it. Which, of course, under normal circumstances, wouldn't be allowed. In other words, a guy can't put himself into a sakana. If they took the sheep, so let him have the sheep. Yeah, you go running after it, you're looking for trouble. What's David doing? But it could be he felt that this lion was obviously going to attack other people. He couldn't leave the lion like that. A bold lion that came, and could be the lion saw that David was there and he wasn't afraid at all. Or it could be David just somehow was inspired. He didn't even feel it was a sakana. But whatever the rationale is, David went after the lion and the bear, and he wasn't afraid at all, and he saved the sheep. Gamis hoari, also the lion. Gam hadov, also the bear. He ka avdecha, your servant struck. And Chazal learned, it could have just said, hoari v'hadov, he ka avdecha. The lion and the bear were killed. What's this? Also the lion. Gam es hoari. Could have said also gam hoari. What's the gam? Es Hoari, Gam Hadov. It's the S and the Gam are to allude the fact that there was more than just one lion and one bear. It was a lion with two cubs, two of the young ones. Gam Eshoari. Gam Hadov, and also the bear, could mean the bear had a child with it. That's the way the Radak learns. Rashi mentions it could be it was a bear with its two offspring. So it was a whole family. So besides the fact that it was the lion and the bear, they had their little cubs there that were also, it was like, they were also involved. And David HaMelech killed them all when he was that shepherd. This plishti, who's an orel who doesn't have that mitzvah bris milah, he'll be kachar mehem, like one of these animals. Ki chayrif, because he disgraced marchos elokim chayim, the battalion, the army of the living Hashem. A person has a greater hashkacha than an animal. Obviously, you know, I mean, accidents happen to people also, and every tragedy is a tragedy. But there are more cats that are hit by cars than people. And there's a special siyata dishmaya. Everybody knows themselves many times what it was almost an accident and it could have been, and nothing, Baruch Hashem, everything worked. The person has a special hashkacha. David HaMelech is adding, I hit the lion and I hit the bear and they were two of them or even more than that. And they were fierce fighters and they were determined and angry. But you'll argue, okay, those are animals. Animals don't have hashkacha, it's not such a big deal. But Goliath, Tzelem Elokim, a person has a special siyata dishmaya. To kill a person, to be against Goliath, I wouldn't be able to. What David said was, Goliath no longer has that special hashkacha. Because of the way he cursed and he disgraced Klal Yisrael and Hashem, he simply lost the tzuras ha'adam. He lost that image that a person who looks like a person, who morachem v'chitchem yiyah. Normally, as long as a person's alive, an animal stays away. An animal normally is scared of people. Because a person has a certain tzura, a certain image that he's a tzelem Elokim. Goliath lost it. Goliath is like an animal now. To speak like that against Klal Yisrael and against Hashem, so the plishti will be kachan mehem, like one of those animals. He's also an animal. And he won't fare any better. I'll also be able to defeat him. Vayomer David. Now David was speaking till now. These last three psukim were all David speaking. Vayomer David seems to imply it's a new approach now. Till now David discussed how you're concerned that I don't have a chance against Goliath. Goliath's such a mighty warrior and I'm a nar. So I'm telling you, Bederach HaTeva, it's not impossible. I've fought against animals and I've overcome and I should be able to defeat Goliath without a problem. But even if you're still hesitating, and Shaul is still not convinced that David could be the one. Vayomer David. David said, you want to know bottom line? You know why I'm prepared to go and fight Goliath? Because Hashem asher hitzilani miyad ho'ariyu miyad hadov. I know it wasn't my physical strength. Hashem saved me from the lion and from the bear. Hu yatzilani miyad ha'plishti azeh. He'll save me from this plishti. In other words, it's not just that I feel that I'm actually stronger, able to overcome Goliath. Of course not. But it's all Hashem. I was saved from the lion and the bear. Hashem will save me from this plishti. Meaning even, and here now is he mentioning, even if he doesn't win the war, but he'll be saved. Could be we'll see how he later on tries to kill Goliath with a slingshot and he succeeds. But even if he would miss the target and he would run out of stones and it wouldn't work, so he'll run away. Don't worry, Hashem will save me. He'll save me from this plishti. And there's a pause. In the Novi, it's written now with a space, as if Shaul's thinking, and there's not an immediate response. But after hearing this argument, that Hashem is the one that will help, that David's saying is it will help us, Vayomer Shaul el David Leich. So Shaul said to David, go, Vashem Yeh Imach. Hashem will be with you. Incidentally, we had in the previously, when Doeg first introduced David to Shaul, and he mentioned all of the praises of David in order to cause Shaul's jealousy and anger, the clincher, what really got Shaul upset was when he said, Vashem Imo, with all the qualities of David, you can see Hashem is with him. The Shekhinah is with him. And then Shaul realized, you know, if Hashem Imo, this guy, he could be the king. But at this moment, Shaul himself used that expression, Vashem Yeh Imoch, Hashem will be with you. That's an expression. You see, even Shaul said that Hashem will be with David. And David should go, and he can go and fight Goliath. Rashi says, Hashem who saved him from the lion. Why did David have to have this experience with a lion and with the bear? A lot of people are shepherds, and a lion and a bear doesn't come and steal a sheep from the flock. Certainly not when they're around to see what's happening. David said, you know, the very fact that I was there and I saw the lion and the bear come together and take the sheep, and I was able to get the sheep away from this lion and bear. So he was given a remez. He was given some type of hint that there's a special hashkacha with him, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is supervising him. Hashem is showing he has abilities and he has capabilities. And David picked up on that. And he said, you know what? If Hashem showed me I could defeat the lion and the bear, it must be that right now I'm supposed to use this for Klal Yisrael. Why is HaKadosh Baruch Hu showing me that I can overcome a much stronger enemy? It must be I'm able to defeat the adversary to show me that I'll be able to defend Klal Yisrael. Rashi gives another example from Chazal. The other example was Mordechai at Tzadik by Purim. Mordechai, the Gadol Hadar from the Sanhedrin. Imagine, and his daughter, the one that he raised like his daughter, by Ominus Hadassah, he was raising Esther. And according to Chazal, she was his wife, he married her. So he's so close with Esther. And Achashverosh takes her away. Mordechai was convinced it must mean that this is being done to save Klal Yisrael. So you see two opposite examples. David HaMelech is given a tremendous success. So he said, a success that I killed the lion and the bear. And I was able to, must mean I can use my abilities and my talents for Klal Yisrael. Mordechai was sort of the other way around. Such a tragedy happened that Esther was taken. Must mean a tragedy like this occurred because Hashem has some special plans. It must be ultimately for the benefit of Klal Yisrael. Why else would this terrible thing happen? That's called living your life with an eye on Klal Yisrael. Whatever happens to him, whether it's good or whether it's bad, what can it be done? What's the message to serve Klal Yisrael? So David said, Hashem who saved me from the lion and the bear, he'll save me from this plishti. It must mean there's a reason why, and it's in order to show me that I should be the one to fight Goliath. Vayalbe Shaul as David Madov. Shaul dressed David in his clothing. Now, we'll see in a minute, V'nosan kova nechoshes al rosho, he put the copper helmet on David's head. Vayalbe shoso shiryon, and he dressed him in the armor. Now, if he wanted to put on armor on David, I'm sure they must have had an extra set of clothing, an extra armored bulletproof vest or whatever. They must have had extra equipment in the camp. But this was a certain, either on Nivus of Shaul, or a certain endearment, or a certain appreciation that David's volunteering. He was waiting and waiting and waiting for somebody to fight Goliath. He took his own clothing, his own royal weapon, armor, his own royal armor, and he put it on David. There's one problem, and that is that Shaul was Mishichmo v'mala gavoya mikol ha'om. Shaul was head and shoulders above the crowd. He was much, much taller than everyone. So it must mean that this armor was somehow, you know, it had adjustable sizes, or they could put it on David, and then they would adjust it to fit his size, because otherwise Shaul was much taller. Vayachkor David escharpo. David put on his sword, me'al lamada, from on top of his clothing, vayoel oleches, and he wanted to go, kilonisa, because he hadn't tried this before. He wasn't used to walking with armor. And interestingly, the Meforshim are bothered. Some learn vayoel oleches. He actually here has the opposite connotation. He didn't want to go with the armor. He couldn't walk because he kilonisa, he wasn't used to it. But whether he wanted to make an attempt or he didn't want to walk with it, just he had to put it on because Shaul gave it to him, he realized he can't go to war like this. Vayomer David el Shaul, so David said to Shaul, lo uchal aleches bo'eile, I can't go with these clothing. Kilonisisi, I'm not accustomed to it. By Yisirang David Me'olav, and David removed it. David took it off. He can't walk with it. Chazal say when David put on the clothing of Shaul, miraculously, they were talking here about the royal clothing. And once David had been anointed with the Shemen HaMishcha, when Shmuel had privately made David the king, the royal clothing fit him. So even though it was a bigger size, Alpines, miraculously, it fit him. And as soon as that happened, without any adjustments, Shaul put it on in a fit. David immediately picked up that Shaul realized that, and Shaul felt bad, and Shaul realized this person here would be the king. He's fit to be the king. Probably he's the one that Hashem said will be the king. So David said, I can't wear it. I'm not used to wearing this. And he took it off, and said, I'm not fit for royalty. I'm not used to wearing these royal clothing, this armor. And David immediately took it off. That we shouldn't, Shaul shouldn't think too much about it. He put it on and it's not for me, and he took it off. And Rashi brings down that chazal. By searing David may all of, so David removed all of these, the armor. And learning through David HaMelech's life, you can see how he lived the Sefer Tehillim. As when he said, Eile ve'erecha ve'eile basusim, that the goyim come with their chariots and their horses, v'anachnu v'shem Hashem elokeinu nazkir, and we call out in the name of Hashem, he did that personally. As if, forget the weapons, forget the armor, he just left it all, and he went out as a shepherd would go out. V'yikach maklu biyodo, he took his stick in his hand. It's a question exactly why he took the stick. Because we'll see, he didn't use it. It could be that we'll see later on, Goliath said to him, what, you're sending me somebody to fight me with sticks? Could be it was like a decoy, you know, as he wanted Shaul to notice the stick without being on the lookout that there's a slingshot here. But whatever the story is, it could be he was going, this was in the valley between the mountains, could be he needed the stick as like a third leg to give him some support. Or it could be, in general, you find for some reason, whatever, by Yaakov Avinu it says, Kiva makli avarti esayarding hazeh, I crossed this yarding with my stick. David took a stick. I don't know what the remez is, what the deeper meaning is, but David took the stick. Vayikach maklo biyodo, he took the stick. Vayivchar lo chamisha chalukei avonim min hanachal. And he took five smooth stones from the stream. The water washed over them over the years, and they were smooth. He took these five stones. They fit snugly in the catapult. And he put them in his shepherd's bag, uvayalkut, and his knapsack. Some learn that kli haroim is actually the knapsack. It means it's sort of redundant, but stressing that this was what he was carrying, the shepherd's bag. Or maybe he put it, there was like the knapsack and the kli haroim, one went inside the other, it was a bag within a bag. But he put the stones in the bag, v'kalo biyodo, and he was holding the slingshot in his hand, v'yigash el ha-plishti, and he drew near to the plishti. Why did he take five stones? There were all these different things that happened with David. They all had deeper meanings, and exactly what the significance is, the Radak brings down a number of explanations. One is he picked up a stone and he said, this stone is because I'm fighting on behalf of Hashem. Goliath spoke out against Hashem that nobody is able to defend Klal Yisrael. So he put a stone in the bag, L'shem Yichud Kutshav Rihu, whatever, this stone is going to be the stone that Hashem will get his revenge against Goliath. And then Goliath had kept on saying how he defeated, how he killed Chofni and Pinchas, the Kohanim, the sons of Eli. He took a stone and he put it in his bag and he said, this stone is because of Aaron HaKoyen, whose great descendant, his grandsons were killed by Goliath. Aaron HaKoyen, the Zechus of Aaron, should help that Goliath should be killed. Put another stone in the bag. And he took another three stones, Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, our Ovois, that Goliath disgraced Klal Yisrael. Put stones in the bag that should kill Goliath. So he took five stones and he put them in the bag. And he drew near to the Plishti. Vayelech ha-Plishti. Vayelech ha-Plishti. The Plishti went. Holech, he was going. Vakarev, and drawing closer. He was approaching El David to David. By David, when David came to the Plishti, the word used was Vayigash. By the Plishti coming to David, it says Holech Vekarev. And the Malbim, as he does many, many times throughout Tanakh, notices exactly the differences in the terms. There's no exact synonyms in Lashon HaKodesh. Every word has its own nuance and its own shade of meaning that you don't find in a different word. Vayigash is a word when somebody on a lower level approaches the greater person. That's Vayigash. Vayigash elov Yehuda. Yehuda was going to go to the ruler of Mitzrayim and try to win the release of Binyamin. So Vayigash elov Yehuda. When Yehuda approached Yosef, they weren't equals. They weren't buddies. They weren't comrades. He was approaching him as a lower level person. He was a commoner, even though he came from the distinguished family of Yaakov. But Yehuda's approaching Yosef by Yigash. Or you'll have, we had by Avram Avinu, when Avram came to daven for stone, by Yigash, he approached HaKadosh Baruch Hu in tefillah. But that's again, on a lower level, you're approaching Hashem by Yigash. When David came to Plishti, it was obvious that David was this nar, this lad, and he wasn't equipped at all to fight. Vayigash el haPlishti. He approached the Plishti. The Plishti was obviously the greater one. When the Plishti came to David, he wasn't, that's like two equals, like somebody greater, where you'd use the term holech v'koriv el David. He came with all of the audacity and all of his brazenness. He approached David as somebody who's greater. Vayish nosei atzina lefonav. And he had the guy who was carrying the shield walking in front of Goliath. We'll see, he doesn't seem to play a role later on. I don't know if when he realized it was just David, he left. And it was, Goliath doesn't need a separate person in front of him. But when they came out, when they initially met, it was David against Goliath, and even Goliath had an assistant, had somebody carrying a tzina, a shield, in front of him. A tzina is a shield that defends a person. It surrounds the body, or is it's on three sides, or maybe even the fourth side. It says in Tehillim, "Katzino rotzon tachrenu." A person should be surrounded with rotzon, with a will, with goodwill from Hashem, like a tzina. So the Plishti had his weapon carrier in front of him, and it seems that Goliath didn't even notice David to begin with. Could be his view was blocked by his the Nosei Hatzino, the weapon carrier blocked his view from David. Or maybe they were at such a distance. But then Vayabed HaPlishti, he gazed, he looked. He looked intently. Vayires David, and then, oh, there knows, yeah, that's Taka David over there. Vayires David Vayivzeyu, and he despised him. That's who you're sending out to fight. V'kihoya nar, because David was a nar. Ve'admoni, and he was reddish. Im yifei einayim, with nice eyes. So he's a handsome person. He's a handsome guy. But just that's who you, that it doesn't look like a warrior. That's who you send to fight. Admoni usually is a sign of somebody who spills blood. So why would that be a reason to despise David? But it could be Admoni means also reddish, means he has an anger. He's a person, he's a fighter, he's the type of person who has an anger. He's an admoni. So they thought to himself, oh, that's who you send. In other words, he gets all upset, so he comes to fight. He's an admoni. He's got his blood is boiling, so he's coming to fight. He doesn't like to hear what the way I'm disgracing Klal Yisrael. But look at him. He's im yifei naim. He has nice eyes. He looks like a person with seichel, somebody who's, lichtige eugen. He looks like a person who's intelligent. He doesn't look like a person, a grub, a coarse person to fight. Vayomer haplishti al David. The plishti said to David, hachelev anochi, do you think I'm a dog? Ki ata boi lai b'maklos, that you're coming to me with sticks? He didn't even mention the stones. It seems they didn't even notice them. The stones were in the bag. All he saw was there was a stick. So you're coming to me with sticks? Vayakalal haplishti es David. The plishti cursed David belohov, mentioning the names of his avodah zorahs, that his of the avodah zorahs of the plishtim, like we had Dagon, that image that had like a fish, half of it was a fish, whatever, the avodah zorahs of the plishtim, they would all help, they would get rid of David. But it was with a scorn. Don't think that when Goliath was killed, all of a sudden he was seized with a fright, or he was scared and he had a heart attack, who knows what happened. Here, when he saw David, his reaction was, what, David? That's who you send to fight. You know, if two warriors have a fight, usually the one who's killed is buried. He lost, but he at least deserves the honor of a proper burial. But here, Goliath was so upset, he took it personally. The fact you're sending me David is a disgrace. You're treating me like a dog. And therefore, when Goliath said when he kills David, he'll throw David to the birds and the animals. Because you're disgracing Goliath, I'll see to it that David is disgraced. Vayomer haplishti el David. So the plishti said to David, Lecho elai, come down to me, ve'ednos besorcha, and I'll give your flesh, le'of ha-shamayim, to the birds of the sky, le'vem ha-sasoda, and the animals of the field. Goliath probably also figured, for 40 days, he had disgraced Klal Yisrael, and his booming voice had echoed through the camp. People weren't even able to concentrate and say Shema. They were terrified of him. And the fact that now they send this person, he's coming, it's like he had thought that his words were having an effect, and he thought Klal Yisrael was demoralized, and he thought he was disgracing them, and all of a sudden he sees that, no, they're treating Goliath like a nothing. And they send out this Nar David, and David don't seem to be afraid at all. So he said to David, he'll throw his flesh to the birds and the animals. The simple meaning, animals includes wild animals and domestic animals. But the truth is, the only ones, the carnivores, are the chayos. The wild animals are those that eat flesh. The cows don't eat meat. Right? The cows and the sheep, they don't eat meat. If he wanted to say he was going to throw David to the wild animals, he should have said, l'chayas hasodeh. And we'll see in a moment, when David said he was going to, that Goliath would be given to the birds and the animals, he used the word chaya. But Rashi says, David sensed again, he picked up that HaKadosh Baruch Hu obviously is with him. Because it's almost as if Goliath lost his mind. Because behemoths don't eat meat. Imagine if he comes to Goliath and Goliath says, I'll throw your flesh to the birds of the sky and to the cows. And the behemoths are sudden, they don't eat meat. So David again picked this up as a signal that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is with him, and Goliath is obviously he's losing his mind, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu will have Goliath killed. Goliath said, come down to me. Could be Goliath wasn't able to run with all of his armor. Could be he felt it wasn't even worth it. There's such a disgrace. He's going to go after David. It's embarrassing. How's he going to go ahead and chase after David? Let David come to him and he'll take care of David. It's beneath Goliath's dignity. As we say, the month of Elul, before Shmini Atzeres, David HaMelech said, Bikrov alai mereyim, lechol es besori. When the evil ones come close to me, to eat up my flesh, tsarei v'oivai li, they're my enemies. Hey, Makosh, they're going to follow. They'll be the ones who will stumble and they'll fall. Im tachna alai machne, if you arrange a camp, an army against me, I won't be afraid. Vayomer David ala plishti. So now David speaks to the plishti. And he says, Ata boila, you're coming to me becherev with a sword, uvachanisa with a spear, uvekidon, a javelin, another kind of spear. You're coming with your weapons. Vonochi boilecha, I'm coming to you b'shem Hashem Tzvokois. And the name of Hashem Tzvokois, and the term Tzava means to have a host, to have control over the whole world with everything in it. So when he says Hashem Tzvokos, he means Hashem who controls the whole world and everything in it, all the hosts of people and creatures and nations, who's Elokei Marchos Yisrael. He is the God, the Midas Hadin, the defender of the Jewish battalions. Asher Cheirafta, that you disgraced. When originally Shaul said, Berulachem Ish, choose for yourself a person and he should come down to me, Chazal mentioned that he was alluding to the fact, let's see if Hashem can do anything for you. Hashem ish milchama. Hashem is the ish milchama. Now David is saying, I'm the one, I am the representative, I'm the shliach of Hashem. You want Hashem to fight you? I'm the shliach of Hashem. And I'm coming to you b'shem Hashem tzvokos and the name of Hashem. And again, throughout what David HaMelech is saying, you see the concepts that is throughout Tehillim, that all of the weaponry, that all of the weapons that a person has and everything he has, it doesn't help. It's all the Yeshua of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That it's the HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants, he'll win. Hayom hazeh yisagercha Hashem biyodi. Today Hashem will give you over in my hand. V'hi kisicha, and I will hit you, Goliath. And I'll remove your head, he said to Goliath. And I'll place the dead bodies of the plishti machne hayom hazeh today la'of hashamayim, to the birds of the sky, ulachayas ha'aretz, and the wild animals of the land. V'yedu kol ha'aretz, and the whole land, everybody will know ki yesh elokim liYisrael, that there's a Kodesh Baruch Hu, there's an Elohim for Klal Yisrael. Or this is a battle that I am on behalf of Klal Yisrael, on behalf of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to show you that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is with us. That's for the Goyim. When you see that Goliath is killed, you realize that there's Elohim be Yisrael. But even for us Yidden, even for us there's a lesson. V'yedu kol hakol hazeh, all of our people, all of our kohol, will all know, kilo becherev uvachanis Yehoshia Hashem. Not with a sword or a spear does Hashem win. And usually it would say Yoshia. Yehoshia is like, you put in an extra hey, it's, you have almost the whole name of Hashem, there are yud and a k and a yud and a hey and above. Yehoshia Hashem. Hashem doesn't save with the weapons. Ki l'Hashem ha-milchama, the war is for Hashem, v'nosayin eschem bi-yodeinu, and Hashem will give you into our hands. And actually the word used is not v'yitein, but v'nosan. It's like it's already done. Hashem has already given you into our hands. You're finished. Now, we're not going to see what Goliath is. It doesn't say exactly what his reaction was. I mean, his reaction was he was furious. He came to fight David, but he didn't say anything. Doesn't make a difference. What, I don't know if he said anything or not. It doesn't make a difference. But the point is the lesson from David HaMelech, that when Goliath is killed, it'll be a lesson for the Goyim and it'll be a lesson for Klal Yisrael. The Chil Hashem of those 40 days of a disgrace, that Goliath disgraced HaKadosh Baruch Hu and Klal Yisrael, will now turn into a tremendous Kiddush Hashem. V'hoya kikom ha-plishti. And it was when the plishti arose. V'yelech v'yikrav likras David. He went and he drew near likras David, toward David. V'yemaher David. David hurried. V'yorat ha-marocha. And he ran toward the battle formation. Likras ha-plishti, toward the plishti. Vayishlach David es yodo. David sent out his hand, Alakeli, into that container, into his knapsack, into the bag. Vayikach mishom evan. He took a stone. Vayakalan. He threw it. He shot it with his catapult, with a slingshot. Vayachas haplishti el mitzcho. And he hit the plishti by his forehead. And there's a discussion exactly how this happened. It could be the helmet didn't totally cover the whole face. Obviously, there was opening for the mouth and, I guess, to breathe, and for the eyes. And the forehead could be, was also not protected. But it was a narrow gap between the space in the helmet, and the stone fit exactly in that spot. Or it could be it was an ace. One shot is that when David said, "I'll give your flesh to the birds," Goliath looked up in the sky to see if there are any birds. And he lifted up his head, and the helmet slipped back, and his forehead was exposed, and the stone hit him. There's even a pshat, there's a medrash that says that the stone was flying in the air, heading straight toward the helmet. And the stone wouldn't have had a chance to pierce through the armor. And it was almost as if the malachim, whoever spoke on behalf of the stone, argued to the malach in charge of the iron, "You have to let the stone pierce the iron this time. It's nogea tremendous kiddush Hashem." And the iron didn't want to budge. Since when does the iron have to allow the stone to go through? So they made a deal. If the iron lets the stone prevail and pierce the iron, the stones that until then had been used for bris milah, like it says, "Vatikach tzipora tzor," Tzipora took a rock and she did the bris on her son. Stones that had been used, a sharp stone that had been used for a bris, would now be used, from this point on, they would use metal. The stone would, the metal would give in to the stone at this point in history, and the stone would, from then on, allow metal to be used for the bris milah. Whatever the pshat is, the stone hit the forehead. Vayachas haplishti el mitzcho, vatipa ho'evan b'mitzcho. The stone sank into his forehead. Vayipol al ponov orza. And Goliath fell on his face to the ground. And there's a few nisim over here. It was a nace that the stone was able to get either through the open area or pierce the armor, or that the helmet slipped so that it went through. It was a miracle that the stone hit the forehead. It was a miracle that a tremendous gibor like Goliath, who I'm sure had a thick skull, besides layers of fat. In those days, fat was considered a strength, a power, but that it was able to pierce through whatever flesh and skin and actually, we'll see, kill Goliath, that the fact that it hit Goliath and caused him to fall, that was an ace. And it was an ace that Goliath fell forward. In fact, Chazal say it was to save David the tircha. The Goliath was a little over six and a half amas tall. If he would have fallen backwards, it would have been a 12 amas and 2 zeres, 2 half amas. A difference between reaching Goliath's head. If Goliath falls forward, his head is close to David. If he falls backwards, his whole height is in the other direction. So even in the midst of the great miracles, this little touch of a favor was done for David. That even though when Goliath was hit with a stone and you would expect him to fall backwards, but Vayibal upon of Arza, he fell forwards to the ground. And it wasn't even like he was, we'll see, it could be he wasn't killed yet, but he wasn't able to fight. He fell on his face, and it wasn't like he got up and he was wounded, but he was down. It could be he fell forward, some learn, just simply because it wasn't like the stone was so big or so forceful that it threw it backwards. It hit him, and he was weakened that he just collapsed, so he fell forward. Another chazal is the mouth of Goliath that had disgraced Hashem and Klal Yisrael, that mouth should now be sunk into the dirt. If he would have fallen backwards, his mouth would be facing the sky. Falling forwards, his mouth is now in the dirt. Vayechzak David mina plishti. David was overpowered the plishti bakela using his slingshot over Evan and the stone. Vayachasa plishti, and he struck the plishti. Vayimiseu, and he killed him. Becherav ein biyad David. But David had no sword. And the fact that it stresses again, he hit him with the kela and the Evan, could be he hit him with more and more stones afterwards, after Goliath was down. Because it says, Vayorats David, David ran, Vayamut al haplishti, and he stood by, Vayamut el haplishti, stood to the plishti, Vayikach escharbo, and he took the sword of Goliath, Vayishlefo, and he pulled it out, Mitara, from the scabbard. Now, Goliath had not pulled out his sword. Goliath figured he would hit David with the kidon, with the javelin. He wasn't planning on using his sword. So David had pulled out the sword, Vayimosesehu, and killed Goliath. As some learned, by Moses say we killed him when he hit him with the stone, but it could be he was hit and he was wounded, and now David used the sword to kill Goliath. Vayichlus boas rosh, and he cut off Goliath's head. Vayiru haplishtim kimeski borum. The plishtim saw that their gibor, their mighty one, died. Vayonusu, and they fled. And we're going to see David went around with Goliath's head, which is not a Jewish type of thing to do. But over here, this Goliath, the fact it was such, it's hard for us to imagine, but the Chil Hashem, for day after day, in front of all of Klal Yisrael, in front of the king, that nobody's able to defeat and to defend Klal Yisrael, it's not our nature. But it's a tremendous Kiddush Hashem, where it's clear that the Russia is defeated. And therefore it seems kind of bizarre, but we're going to see David took Goliath's head and he went around, because it's important to be mefarsim the miracle that Goliath was killed. Vayakumu anshe Yehuda, Yisrael v'Yehuda, the people of Yisrael and Yehuda got up vayariu, and they shout cries of victory. Vayirdefus haplishtim, and they chased after the plishtim at Boach Hagai till they came to the valley. Vadshari Ekron, to the gates of Ekron. That was a city of the plishtim. Vayiplu chalalei plishtim b'derech sharayim. The dead bodies of the plishtim fell on that road of sharayim, vad gas, vad ekron. These are different cities of the plishtim, sharayim, gas, and ekron. By the road, they were running away. Klal Yisrael was chasing after them, and they killed plishtim along the way. It's interesting, because they didn't enter the cities of the plishtim. It was like the plishtim ran back to their cities, and Klal Yisrael chased after them. Maybe they felt that this whole thing was a miracle, and they were afraid to go further. In other words, they were sure that HaKadosh Baruch Hu would save them from the plishtim, but they didn't go into the cities. Vayashuvu b'nei Yisrael, the b'nei Yisrael returned midalok achrei plishtim, from pursuing after the plishtim. Vayashosu es machaneim, and they plundered whatever the plishti camp had abandoned. When they fled the scene, Klal Yisrael took all of the spoils. Vayikach David es rosh haplishti. David took the head of the plishti. Vayivyei Yerushalayim, and he brought it to Yerushalayim. And Chazal say he actually traveled around from one city to another. He made his routes. Eventually he came to Yerushalayim. At this point in history, Yerushalayim was not even the focal point of the nation. David is the one who made Yerushalayim the capital city. But he brought it to Yerushalayim. In fact, the Radak brings down a pshat that Nov Irakoanim was called Yerushalayim over here. When it says he brought it to Yerushalayim, he really means the city of the Kohanim. The Kohanim are usually in Yerushalayim. At this point, they were in Nov. And the Radak says, why should we learn that? Why should we learn that way? One of the other Mephorshim says, to learn that way in the Pesukim is a stretch. I mean, it says Yerushalayim. But if there's such a Kabbalah, in other words, there must be some Medrash, must be some Chazal, if that's what it means, that's what it means. But whether he brought it to Yerushalayim, or he brought it to Nov, or he brought it to the other cities, Ves Kalev Som Ba'ahalo, the Kalem of Goliath, his weapons, his Kalem, his armor, he placed in his tent to remember always the miracle that Goliath was killed and HaKadosh Baruch Hu defended Klal Yisrael. V'chiros Shol Es David. When Shaul saw David, Yotze Likras HaPlishti, going out to greet toward the Plishti. Omar, he said, El Avner Sarat Sova, to Avner his general, Ben Mizeh Hanar, the son of who? is this nar, this lad, the one of the young person who's going to fight. Who's he the son of? Avner. Who's he the son of? Bayomer Avner. So Avner says, Chei nafshecha melech, I swear by the life of the king. Obviously, if he's swearing, he realizes the king is very, this is a very important question the king is asking. Not every time the king asks a question, do you respond with an oath? But he realizes that this question is a monumental question. So he said, I swear, Chei nafshecha melech, im yodati, I swear that I don't know. Bayomer HaMelech, so the king said, throughout it's used the word shol. You look through it, it says the Pasuk Chafei, the hero shol. But here it doesn't say Vayomer shol. It says Vayomer HaMelech, almost as if this is a royal command. The king said, Sha'al Atah, go and ask, Ben Mizeh Ho'olem, who is this Elam, this young lad? Like an Alma is a young girl and an Elam is a young boy. Who's he the son of? And Chazal say Na'ar is more of a, is not as, it's a little bit of a derogatory term. Ha'olam is a nicer term. So when he's going around and I want you to go and ask and find out who he's the son of, refer to him as an Olam, which is a more of a complimentary term. But go and ask, who's he the son of? And we're going to see, it's amazing. And then before Shmuel will talk about it. What do you mean? David had been by Shaul all of this time. Whenever Shaul had a depression, David was playing the music, and it says Shaul loved David. I mean, and all of a sudden he doesn't know. And like, who's he? Who's David? Some of Farshim say that obviously David was the Shechina rested on David when he went down to fight Goliath. The Shechina went on him that he looked like a different person, and nobody recognized him. As he didn't look like David had looked before. Some say could be he had the Ruach Roh at this moment, and somehow he Taka forgot, and as he was overcome. But then it's strange that Avner didn't know who it is. Chazal say, although before we get to Chazal, one other explanation, B'derech HaPshat, the Abarbanel said, of course he knew who David was. David's the musician. And in fact, he had heard from Doeg, David had certain qualities. But the fact that he actually was going out to fight Goliath, and or this, he actually asked this question before Goliath was killed, but he saw David Yotze Likras HaPlishti, going out toward the Plishti. He wanted to know, who's David's father? Is his father a mighty warrior? Where do you create such a person with the fortitude and the courage to go out toward Goliath? Ben Mizeho Elam, who's he the son of? Ben Mizehanar, who's he the son of? And the focus is, who's his father? I want to know, is his father a warrior? And that Avner said, I don't know. Yishai was an old person at that point. And we learned he was Baba Anoshim, he came with a whole entourage. Wherever he went, he had a lot of people, and he was a Zokain, and he was a Chocham. But you're asking me, was his father a Gibor? I don't know, his father's an old man now. I don't know if his father used to be a mighty warrior. But Chazal say a pshat, the Gemara in Yevomis, Dafayin Zayin, and Rashi brings it down over here. This was a much, much deeper question than how is David going out to fight Goliath. Shaul realized that David is royalty. Whether it's because the clothing of Shaul were put on David and they fit. And David took them off, it only took a moment. Oh, David put them on, he couldn't wear them, he took them off, and he went out. As soon as he saw David, Yotze Likras HaPlishti, David, as soon as, I guess David was out of earshot, as soon as David stepped out, Shaul realized, David's going to be the king. Ben Mizeh Hanar, who's he the son of? I know he comes from Shevet Yehuda. Yehuda had a son, Peretz, and a son, Zerach. If he came from Peretz, it's a sign, if he's a descendant of Peretz, which David was, that means he'll be a king. When Tamar was giving birth to the twins, Zerach was going to be born first. In fact, the red string was tied around him because he was the first. He would have been the first. And Peretz like broke through and got and was actually born first. A king has that right to break through. If the king wants to travel from his palace to his vineyard and there's something in the way, he melech poyretz geder. A king can break through. Peretz is the sign of royalty. If David is from Peretz, he definitely will be the king. And if he's from Zerach, that's the other son of Tamar from Yehuda's family, he'll be a chosh of a person, but he won't be king. So as soon as this transpired, Ben Mizeh Hanar, who is he the son of? I want to know his yichus. And there's more than we see in the Psukim. Here we are introduced to Doeg again. The Gemara says, Doeg responded and he said, you want to know whether he's fit to be the king or not? I don't know if he's fit to marry a Bas Yisrael. He can't even marry into Klal Yisrael. Because Lo Yovo Amoini Umoabi Bikal Hashem, somebody from Moab is not allowed to marry into Klal Yisrael. And David descended from Rus HaMoaviyah. So Avner said, what do you mean? Amoni v'lo Amonis, Moavi v'lo Moavis. The decree is only on the men, not on the women. So Doeg said, and when it says a mamzer can't marry in Klal Yisrael, does it mean a mamzer, not a mamzeres? Of course, mamzer, the term includes both. So Avner responded, yeah, but the reason the Torah says, the reason why they can't marry into Klal Yisrael was al-davar shir lokid mueskim balechem uvamayim, because they didn't come out to greet Klal Yisrael with bread and water when they left Mitzrayim. That's why they can't marry into Klal Yisrael. And a woman doesn't go out. So Doeg said, what do you mean? A woman doesn't go out to greet the men, but the women should have come out to greet the women. So there was a whole lumdisha halacha discussion over here. Is David able to marry into Klal Yisrael or not? And Avner didn't have an answer. So Shaul said to him, Sha'al ata, go and ask Ben Mizeh Ha'olem. The word olem can mean to mean hidden. Find out this halacha is hidden from you. To be continued.